Well, tomorrow afternoon, the U.S. Supreme Court will hear a case that could change affirmative action forever. The issue? The state of Michigan's Proposition 2. That's a voter-approved law that bans any consideration of race in public college admissions. A law detractors say would make Jim Crow proud. Michigan Attorney General Bill Schuette joins us tonight. His office is defending the law, and that's not from me, Mr. Attorney General. That is from the detractors who say this is a Jim Crow law because it bans the consideration of race in the admissions process at the Michigan college level. What say you?
Well, listen, first, thank you for the opportunity to be here. Congratulations on week two of your show.
Thank you.
And I'm very confident, Megyn, that we and the United States Supreme Court will uphold Michigan's Constitution. And what we're saying in Michigan is that we're requiring equal treatment because it's wrong. It's fundamentally wrong to treat people differently based on the color of your skin, your race, your gender, ethnicity, national origin. We're saying no. And the only thing we're discriminating against in Michigan is discrimination itself.
They say, look, the state of Michigan is it's 85% white. And they argue that 90% of the black voters cast ballots against this law. Two-thirds of the white voters supported it. So they say since Michigan is 85% white, there's a gap in political power in that state, and therefore you can't just have the voters pass a law saying no more consideration of race in the admissions process.
You know, that's just nonsense. What we doing in Michigan is embracing Chief Justice Roberts' famous quote when he said, the best way to stop racial discrimination is to stop discriminating on the basis of race. And what we're doing in Michigan is we're requiring equal treatment, and we have 15 universities, and we wanted to do it with one approach saying it is wrong to treat people differently on the basis of the color of your skin or your race. And so we are requiring equal treatment. And the root discussion also here that we're talking about, Megyn, is we need to have an education revolution in America. We need to have diversity on college campuses, but we need to do it constitutionally, not by any means necessary.
But here's what they say in response to that, because they point to the numbers, as proponents of affirmative action always do. And they say that, look, back when, before they had this law, Proposition 2, that the Michigan's Ann Arbor, University of Michigan's Ann Arbor campus, it had 6.5% black students. That was in 05. Since the law, only 4.7% are black. And so they say once they passed this law banning affirmative action, black students suffered.
You know, I'm a big fan of diversity. We need it on college campuses and across the country. And we need to do a better job in Michigan and across the land. Now, listen, Florida, for example, is doing a great job with more minority admissions. And so is California and Texas. And we ought to have the same passion and commitment in academic recruitment as we do in athletic recruitment, because we ought to make sure that we're looking for that talented person who has the ability to compete in America. We do that athletically. We need to have that same passion and commitment for education. We need to have an education revolution, and the real core here is to deal with pre-collegiate schooling, because for too long, you know, minority youth in urban areas are being stiffed and shortchanged, and there are other ways to
improve the academic process before these applicants become applicants, and therefore improve their sort of resumes when they're trying to get into the school. So I want to ask you this.
Well, we need to go right in schools and middle schools and do a better job and give those minority youths an opportunity to compete.
I know, but the argument on the other side is that's going to take a long time. The argument on the other side is that's going to take a long time, and in the meantime, you've got black applicants who are suffering, and I understand the argument on the other side is, well, you're having white applicants who aren't getting in, and they should, but for the color of their skin. Here's what I want to ask you. If you win this case, because you lost at the lower court, Michigan,
I think we're going to win.
If you win, and by the way, our viewers should know that the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, the left-leaning Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals out in California, they actually found a similar law okay. They said it's okay. So we have a split in the circuits. The lower circuit,
yes, we do.
In Michigan said your law's bad. Now this is going to go up to the U.S. Supreme Court. If you win and the Supreme Court reverses the lower court, this affects not only Michigan, but how many states?
Well, I'm very confident that we will win and the Michigan Constitution will be upheld. And I think the other key thing is states are laboratories of democracy, and we're seeing different ways to have diversity. I'm optimistic that we can have diversity and across our country by constitutional means. Now, remember, the Supreme Court...
How many states, to my question? Are we talking about potentially 50 states if they all passed a law like the one Michigan has?
Well, we see... about 9 states across the country, the 28% of the population is having legislation or constitutional amendments that require equal treatment. So we have great opportunity to achieve diversity in America, but we need to do it by constitutional means.
I want to tell our viewers that it's going to be an 8-person court. Elena Kagan recused herself, so you guys
need the four
conservatives, and you need to get Kennedy. He's the swing vote, and we will continue to follow it. Thank you so much, Mr. Attorney General, for being here.